Hello, my name is George Aguilar. I'm the training manager here at Cla-Val headquarters in Costa Mesa. In today's video, we're going to be discussing the rebuild of our Hytrol main valve along with service kit and repair kit options. Let's get started. So first off, we're going to want to make sure that you have the correct information before we rebuild our valve. There's a couple of pieces of literature that you can find on our website. The first one that I want to discuss with you is our Hytrol service data sheet. Again, this is going to be available on the website. There's a lot of good information on here as far as stem travel, cover chamber capacity, right? How much fluid is on the cover. Now, when it comes into service, the size of the threads, all right, how many there are, the thread types on the body, the thread sizes on the cover, even torque requirements for the cover bolts. You're going to find all of that information on this valve data sheet. You're going to find that in our IOM. The other sheet I'd like to show you is our parts list. All right, within this parts list right here, you have various part numbers, various part sizes, and their descriptions, along with options of our repair kits along the bottom. Now, when we're talking about repair kits, we have optional service kits available. Again, this sheet is also going to be available on our website. So this Hytrol main valve service kits is our variety of repair kits. Let's discuss those real quick. So the first one that we have is going to be our rubber kit. Our rubber kit is just going to include your rubbers, which is your diaphragm and your disc. You'll also get a couple of extra spacer washers as well. That's our standard rubber kit. The second kit is going to be a repair kit. All right, the repair kit is going to include the internal iron parts. So again, this is cast iron. You have an epoxy-coated diaphragm washer, an epoxy-coated disc retainer, as well as your rubber kit. All right, that's going to be our repair kit, our standard repair kit. The next repair kit is going to be our rebuild assembly. Now, our rebuild assembly looks like this. You get everything. You get your rubber kit, you get your repair kit, and then you're going to also get a new stem, a new disc guide, all right, new stem nut. Everything is going to be assembled. You'll even get your spring, a new spring, and that plastic protective washer. All right, so you'll get everything. Everything will be included with that rebuild assembly. You'll also receive the bolts and those stainless steel washers. All right, now these stainless steel washers and these the nuts and these stainless steel washers, that's gonna be our last repair kit, which is just the stud and nut kit itself. All right, so you have four options: the rubber kit, the repair kit, and the rebuild assembly, along with that stud and nut kit. All right, now the last thing before we get started here is going to be an option of our recommended tools. So you'll see listed here is a list of the recommended tools: wrenches, screwdrivers. Now, we don't give sizes. You know, that data sheet that I just was referencing will have socket sizes for the various cover bolts and whatnot. So if you're curious as to what sizes those are, that will be in that data sheet. But as you see here, those will be all of your recommended tools. All right. So now let's get started with the rebuild of our Hytrol. So let's go ahead and get our valve going here. So what we're going to do is we're just going to be rebuilding it using our rubber good repair kit. All right. First things first, when rebuilding these valves, you want to make sure that you have confirmed isolation. All right. Your inlet, your outlet gate valves, whatever your isolation is, butterflies, whatever that is, confirm isolation before you start to tear apart your valve. All right, we've confirmed isolation. Now what we're going to do is we're going to vent the cover. We're going to loosen up one of these cover nuts. If you have your pilot system on here, you're going to loosen that up. We're going to get that water off of the cover of the valve. All right, get that water displacement going, remove that water. Now, we're going to take some pictures, right? Get your phone out, take some pictures of the valve. Make sure you know how that pilot system is going to line back up onto that valve. And then we're going to make a witness mark. You're going to take a screwdriver, a pen, whatever you have, and make an indicator from the cover to the body. All right, anywhere. We want to make sure that we get this cover back on the same position that it is on right now for that pilot tubing, those pilot tubing connections. All right, once we've done that, again, you're going to look at your data sheet. You're going to see what size these sockets are. If you're using an impact or, you know, some type of socket wrench or ratchet, we're going to loosen these up, get all these cover nuts off of here. All right. Now, sometimes these covers will be a little bit stubborn to get off. Again, there's no packing glands. There is no locating pins. There's nothing that is keeping this cover in a specific position. All right. Sometimes these covers, like I mentioned, will be a little bit stubborn to get off. We do have locating lips around the edge. All right. If you needed to get a chisel to get underneath here, to lift that cover up, right? That's fine, that's what that lip is there for. Just make sure that if you are hammering on this cover, that you're working your way around the edges and you're not just banging up on one side of the cover, all right? The machining tolerances being what they are, you don't wanna cause any type of damage to the stem by hitting on one side of that cover. All right, so we get that cover off. We'll set that cover aside. There's our spring. Here's that plastic washer as well. Now we can get in there. Now we also have all of our stems, or have this female thread for sizes on that thread type. Again, you can refer to that data sheet. So there's that thread. Again, you can use that for those that have joined us in some of our online courses. We've talked about those stem pullers. That is what that threads into. All right, that stem puller also works to help carry and pull this assembly out. All right, you have that stem puller. You can carry there, set that assembly aside. Now let's talk about servicing the body. All right. Now, servicing the body here, you can see this area right here is going to be our diaphragm support area. So you want to make sure that that's clear of any type of debris or buildup. All right, there's our seat. So if you're using 400 wet dry sandpaper or some type of non-abrasive wire wheel, right? If you're using that wheel, you want to make sure that you're staying in a circular motion when cleaning this seat. All right, this is that seat surface, right? This is where it's touching that disc. You wanna make sure that that's free from any type of buildup. Bring that seat back to its original shine, all right? Also at this point, it's kinda good to feel around your body here, this Hytrol body. Make sure there's no pitting, any type of, you know, some of that epoxy maybe chipping off, any types of noticing for wear and tear. All right, also you'll see you have our body plugs, right? One on the inlet, one on the outlet, or one on each side, I'm sorry. You wanna make sure that you take those body ports. If you have an inline strainer that's right here, you wanna make sure that you're cleared. Those ports are clear of any type of buildup as well. All right, basic cleanup on that Hytrol body. Let's talk about the cover. Now your cover here, again, This here is your diaphragm support area. You want to make sure that's built free from any type of buildup. You see these record serrations on here. These record serrations, this is where it's touching the diaphragm. There's no need to put any type of lubrication or anything in here. Again, these valves do not require any type of lubrication. There's no packing glands internally as well. So you have these serrated edges. You have them on the body as well, all right? When everything is clamped up and this cover is put on, that is what's giving us basically an extra O-ring seal onto this diaphragm. So, again, diaphragm support area, make sure that that's clear. These mechanical stops that you see here, 1, 2, 3, 4, you wanna make sure that those are clear from any buildup. And then you have a cover bearing. So this cover bearing, again, wrap up a little bit of that 400 wet dry sandpaper inside this bearing surface area inside. You'll notice on these cover bearings, you have these little holes right here. There's one on the top, there's one on the bottom. Those holes are drilled through that cover bearing. That cover bearing sits at about right here. Those holes allow water to get up into this upper section of the cover and to any type of a position indicator or any other accessories. You want to make sure that that water is able to get through and we're not trapping any type of air in this upper column of the cover. All right. Same as before with the body, you want to make sure that those cover connections or there's body port connections are clear. Same thing with the cover. All right, you can see our cover connections. There's one back there, 2, 3, and 4. You wanna make sure that those are free from any type of buildup as well. All right? Now with our diaphragm assembly. All right, our diaphragm assembly here, again, this area, along with this bottom surface here, this is where our bearing support is. This is what is our cover bearing and our seat bearing. Being that these are those bearing surfaces, you want to make sure that you are not, I stress not, using any type of pipe wrench on these surfaces. Okay? We're going to use a crescent wrench for this example here. And what I have done in the past is holding this crescent wrench like this, right? And giving it a little bit of a bang here. That will loosen up this stem nut. Now before you do that, before you loosen that up, you want to make sure before you remove that all the way, these exposed threads, right? These exposed threads that are right here, you want to make sure that you clean those exposed threads. Again, with that wire wheel or some type of file, clean those exposed threads. Then you can continue removing this stem nut. All right. Now let's get this assembly assembled. So we have our stem, again, bearing surface on the top, bearing surface on the bottom, a little bit of that wet dry sandpaper, keep that clear, clean this bottom off, you're good to go. Again, if you are using a wire wheel for this, make sure that you're constantly turning this stem and you're not just working one area of that bearing surface. Same thing with the bottom, all right? Continue moving that stem, not staying or focusing on just one edge of that stem. All right, set that aside. Now, sometimes this disc guide will be a little difficult to come off. All right, so we'll loosen that up. And now, here are those infamous spacer washers. So you guys can see here, we have 2, 4, 6 spacer washers. Now the stories with these spacer washers is, why are there only two in the repair kit when I have six that are in my main valve here? The reason is that these spacer washers basically work as shims, all right? Again, the machining tolerances of the internals of our valves being what they are, epoxy coated, non-epoxy coated, maybe stainless steel disc retainers, the distance between this surface area and this lower surface area will change. Once assembled, we try to clear this gap between the two. All right, we try to clear that gap, and that's where these spacer washers come in. You do not need to replace all of these spacer washers. They are still good. These spacer washers are made of a fiber gasket material. All right, they will dry and shell up and curl up if you leave them out in the heat. So what we'd like to, or what we suggest, is you take these spacer washers, do not try to separate them, don't try to cut them up or anything. Just take them and keep them in a cup of water. Keep them wet. They are still reusable. Save the ones that come in the repair kit and you're good to go. So we got our spacer washers sitting in water. Our disc guide, again, simple wire wheel, wet dry sandpaper. Make sure we're cleaning these edges off. You'll also notice that there is a tiny hole here as well. Make sure that that hole is cleared up with the pick, whatever tool you have. The disc retainer. We want to make sure that the edges on the disc retainer are clear from any type of buildup. We want to make sure that this valve is able to modulate without any type of disruption. So we want to make sure these edges are clear along with this diaphragm support area along the edges. The top side here, you're not going to see any type of buildup. That's where that diaphragm has laid, is laid out. You will notice those record serrations again. That's because that's where our diaphragm is sealing. All right, no lubrication there. Now, removing this disc, you want to make sure that you do not remove this disc by prying off the edges. This is incorrect. Do not do that. All right, you want to come from the top of the disc guide or the disc retainer. Come from the top, maybe give it a good whack with a hammer, dig into that disc and peel that disc back. Work your way around and peel that disc back. That's one option. A second option is to use a pick, right? If you use a pick, you can dig into it as such and then kind of peel it back like that, just until it starts to lift. Again, do not come off the edge like this. That is no good. All right, so now we got that disc out. We're good. And that is all of our disc retainer cleanup. Let's talk about our diaphragm washer. Again, our diaphragm washer, these edges right here, these are our support. This is our diaphragm support area. Make sure that those are clear from any debris. Again, not much cleanup on the flat surface. There's those record serrations on the top side. Make sure that you clean up any of those larger boogers that are on top. This machine flat right here, this is where those mechanical stops are going to make contact. Make sure that these are clear from any debris. Again, being that this valve is all epoxy coated, valves that are epoxy coated obviously are going to take less time to rebuild. So, you know, we usually suggest to go with epoxy. That's why these epoxy coated parts do come with that repair kit. All right, now let's go ahead and assemble everything back together here. We're all good. We have our new parts, right? That diaphragm, we're just going to be replacing the two, the disc and that diaphragm. So let's go ahead and get our disc retainer, our new disc guide. All right, those spacer washers that we had sitting in the water, right? We have these. We'll set those in there. We have our disc guide. We'll get our stem. Now the diaphragm. Now the diaphragm, there is no top or bottom to a diaphragm. The one thing that we suggest is having the date stamp and that part number facing up. This way, once this valve is assembled, and we get our diaphragm washer on top, we get our stem nut. Our stem nuts, by the way, they do have a slight flat that's on the top of the stem nut here. The flip side on the top, there it is curved. So you want that flat, which is almost like a washer, to be facing down. All right, and then you can tighten this up to that spec. Again, this stem nut torque will be on that data sheet that we discussed earlier. Now, everything's assembled. I talked about the date stamp. This is why we want the date stamp facing up, because when we throw this assembly into the valve, that date stamp is now going to be covered by the cover itself. And the next time we remove this cover, now you're gonna know how old that diaphragm is. It is a four-digit number. In this case, it's 2Q12. That will show you, that's gonna tell you how old that diaphragm in your valve is going to be. All right? Now, as far as the diaphragm assembly, it does not matter which way you set this in here. All right, it can be in any position. We set that in the valve. We have our plastic washers. We have our spring. We're gonna make sure we wanna make sure we do not forget these. And then we're gonna get our cover on. Now remember, we're gonna look for that indicator mark, right? We're gonna look for that indicator mark of where our cover is supposed to line up, which is right there. There we go. We'll get our cover bolts on here. And we do suggest a star pattern when tightening up this cover. All right, so we go into star pattern. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. And we're all tightened up. Again, these torque numbers will be available on that data sheet. That concludes the rebuild of our 100 series main valve. Please visit our website for more videos, along with the calendar of future online classes. Thanks for watching and have a great day.